we will discuss about another topic known as deviation from Mendel's law. Genetic experiments, everybody believed what was told by Mendel. Okay? Mendel said that characters transfer from the parent to the offspring. He spoke about dominance. When we have two alleles, dissimilar alleles in a heterozygous condition, we already know what is a heterozygous condition. When we have dissimilar alleles coding for one particular character or controlling a particular character, in these genes, one particular allele is completely dominant, other allele is recessive. Okay, this is what was explained by Mendel. In a pair of dissimilar alleles, one allele is totally dominant, the other allele is totally recessive. So the allele which is dominant, it will express. The allele which is recessive, it will be suppressed. It will not express its character. Okay. Now, this was not agreed by everybody. Okay. Everyone did not agree what was told by Mendel, because in our earth, or even, you know, when we look into the environment, we see so many varieties of different plants, different animal species, right? Different microbial species. So if the offsprings exactly resemble their parents, then we won't be seeing so much variation in our nature, right? So this is the reason there were few other experiments were conducted in order to prove that what Mendel explained is not 100% true. That those work are known as deviations from Mendel's law. Mendel was going in a particular route, okay? Mendel was explaining, or Mendel was believing certain principles. Certain other principles apart from Mendel principles are known as deviation from Mendel's law, okay? There are certain other things also, or there are certain other concepts which are away from Mendel, what Mendel explained. Okay, so let's study about such work done by other people. The first concept that we know, that we should know, is incomplete dominance. Okay, such concept that we have to know under deviation from Mendel's law is incomplete dominance. Now, we know what is dominance. A dominant allele in a heterozygous condition will express its character, whereas the recessive allele will be suppressed. Okay, and that is known as dominance. In a pair of dissimilar factors, one member of the factor always expresses itself, whereas the other is always recessive. A condition which is away, or which is not true with reference to dominance, is known as incomplete dominance. Incomplete dominance states that when we have a pair of allele, if no allele is completely dominant or recessive, that condition is known as incomplete dominance. Now we have a condition, we have two dissimilar alleles. Here no allele is completely dominant or no allele is completely recessive, both the alleles will express their character. That condition is known as incomplete dominance. In a pair of alleles, I'll give you an example to make it much more clear. In a pair of alleles, no allele is completely dominant or completely expressed for a trait. Okay, now when we have capital T, small t, a pair of alleles, one allele is completely dominant, other allele is completely recessive. Whereas, what incomplete dominance explains is that when we have a pair of alleles, no allele is completely dominant, no allele is completely recessive, both the alleles are expressed for a particular character. Now, if you have capital T, then the character exhibited will be tallness. When you have small t, the character exhibited will be dwarfness. When we have small t, the character exhibited is tallness. That means capital T is dominant. The allele which is dominant, it will show its character. That is explained by Mendel. But according to incomplete dominance, when you have two alleles, imagine a medium-sized plant is obtained. When you have two dissimilar alleles, the allele for tallness, the allele for dwarfness, when both of them they are present together, then if you obtain a medium-sized plant, then this condition is known as incomplete dominance. That means, in this heterozygous condition, a new character will be expressed, okay, which is not similar to both the parents. Okay, here in the F1 generation, when we got this condition, this particular plant was resembling one of the parent, right, the tall plant. Whereas in the incomplete dominance, when we get a F1 hybrid, this hybrid plant is neither matching the father, neither matching the mother. They are not matching any of the parents. They will develop their own individual character. So here, no allele is completely dominant or no allele is completely recessive. They both will exhibit their character. Okay, that is the reason you get a character which neither matches the male parent nor matches the female parent. Okay, so this is the condition. This condition is known as incomplete dominance. In other words, you can say that one allele is not completely dominant over the other allele. Otherwise, in other words, you can say both the alleles are incompletely dominant. That means both the alleles are not able to express their character. Okay, both the alleles are incompletely dominant. That's why we say incomplete dominance. The alleles are not able to show the complete dominance over the other allele. One allele is not able to show the complete dominance over the other allele. Both the alleles are incompletely dominant. That means both the alleles are mixing together and they are showing their own character. Okay, both the alleles will exhibit their characters. This is known as incomplete dominance. Let's study this with the help of a plant known as snapdragon or Antirrhina majus. Okay, I'll give you the example of snapdragon. Or the scientific name is Antirrhina majus. Okay, so we will actually, this plant produces generally red color flowers and white color flowers. So if we cross a red color bearing plant with a white color bearing plant, we'll consider the parental generation. Okay, we can take capital M and capital R to represent a red color flower bearing plant, and small r and small r for a white color bearing plant, white color flower bearing plants. Plant with red flowers, plant with white flowers. When we cross these two plants, okay, we will get the gametes. Gametes will be capital R here, small r here, And when we get the F1 generation, it will be capital R and small r. Now, you see here, this is a heterozygous condition where both the alleles are different. Here, according to, if you had to go according to Mendel's law, then Mendel's incomplete dominance, then this particular condition, heterozygous condition, should have plants with red flowers. Right? According to, if Mendel's law was correct, 100%. However, actually when these two plants were crossed, the plants that we got had pink color flowers. It is a condition where in a heterozygous condition, the F1 plants do not resemble both the parents. They don't resemble both the parents. They are not having red flowers, they are not having white flowers. They have a new combination in a heterozygous condition, that is pink flowers. This is known as incomplete dominance. That means here in this pair of alleles, no allele is dominant. Actually, capital R should have been dominant, but in this case, capital R is not dominant, whereas small r is also not dominant. If small r was dominant, we would have got white flowers. If capital R was dominant, we would have got red flowers. We have not got both red flower and white flower. We got pink flower. That means this allele is not dominant, this allele is not dominant. Both are expressing for a particular character or for a particular trait. Both are expressing for a particular trait. This condition is known as incomplete dominance. Both the alleles are incompletely dominant, or one allele is incompletely dominant over the other allele. It's not a complete dominance. If it was complete dominance, we would have got red or white flowers. We have got pink flowers. That means this allele is incompletely dominant over this allele. This allele is incompletely dominant over this allele. Okay? Then let's talk about the F2 generation. We will do selfing. We will self-pollinate the hybrid plant, two hybrid plants like this. Okay, then we will get the gametes. We will get the gametes as capital R, small r into capital R and small r. Right, these are the gametes. Then what do we get in F2 generation? Capital R, capital R, small r, capital R, small r, small r and small r. Let's write the phenotype. Capital R definitely indicates a red flower plant. Capital R, small r, pink. Capital R, small r, pink. Small r, white flowers. Okay, so this is the actual crossing for a incomplete dominance. Then, if we have to write the genotypic ratio, genotypic ratio means the genetic constitution of that particular plant. For that, we have to take the possible combination of alphabets that we have got R, capital R, small r, and small r. How many capital R? 1. Capital R, small r? 2. Small r? 1. And let's write the phenotypic ratio. Red flower, pink flower, the character that you can observe is the color, right? White color flower, bearing plants. How many red? 1. How many pink? 2. How many white? 1. If you look into this ratio, it is different from your Mendel's monohybrid ratio. When Mendel conducted monohybrid cross, the phenotypic ratio that he got was 3:1 and the genotypic ratio was 1:2:1, whereas in case of incomplete dominance, genotypic ratio remains the same. It's 1:2:1. However, the phenotypic ratio is 1:2:1 instead of 3:1 of Mendel's monohybrid cross. In Mendel's monohybrid cross, phenotypic ratio was 3:1. Here in case of incomplete dominance, the phenotypic ratio is 1:2:1. Okay, so this is about incomplete dominance. Since the result is not same as Mendel's crossing result, it is known as deviation from Mendel's law, something different from Mendel's law. Okay, the example is incomplete dominance. Here we got a phenotype which is not resembling both the parents. We got a new phenotype that indicates that in this allelic pair, no allele is completely dominant, no allele is completely recessive. Both the alleles, they express their character. Okay, they express themselves for a particular character. I hope this is clear to you. Let's study about one more concept known as codominance, which will also come under deviation from Mendel's law, something not told by Mendel, something different from what is said by Mendel. Next concept under deviation from Mendel's law is codominance. Okay, you carefully observe or listen to these terms known as dominance, incomplete dominance and codominance. Dominance means when we have a pair of allele, one allele is dominant, other allele is recessive. In incomplete dominance, we have studied that when we have pair of alleles, no allele is dominant, no allele is recessive, both will express themselves for a particular trait which do not resemble both the parents. Right, in incomplete dominance, we studied that no allele is completely dominant, no allele is completely recessive, both of them will express. Here, only one allele will express, the other allele will remain silent. In this case, both the alleles will express, and the character that we get will not resemble both the parents. Here in case of snapdragon, we got pink flowers, whereas the parent had red and white flowers. So it was not resembling the parent, it was not similar to the parents. Next concept, under codominance, we will see a condition where the F1 generation hybrid or the offspring, F1 generation offspring, had character similar to both the parents. They were expressing the characters of both the parents. I hope you are able to differentiate in codominance. Co means together. When two alleles are present, both the alleles are expressing their character, and this character matches with both the parents. Okay, in incomplete dominance it is same. Both the alleles are expressing themselves. However, the offspring, or in the F1 generation, the offsprings that we get, they do not resemble both the parents. Not even one parent. Whereas in case of codominance, it is together dominance. That means both the alleles are expressing and the offsprings that we get, they resemble both the parents. This condition is known as codominance. Okay, let's study it with the example of human blood group. Okay, human blood group is generally referred as ABO blood grouping. So, what is codominance? When the F1 generation resembles both the parents. Imagine a offspring resembling both the parents. Okay, it cannot be happening. something in terms of physical appearance. However, it is possible when we take an example of ABO blood grouping or human blood grouping. Now, in human body, how we decide ABO blood grouping? Okay, in the first year class we have studied based on the antigen and the antibodies. Antigen present on the plasma membrane and the antibodies present in the blood plasma. We classify the human blood group as A, B, AB or O, and depending upon the Rh factor we will call them positive and negative. Now let's not talk about all the antigen antibody thing. We will see, we will take an example of ABO blood grouping in order to study the codominance. Now this is RBC. RBC has a plasma membrane, red blood cell. It has a plasma membrane, right? On top, in the plasma membrane of every RBC of human blood, there will be something known as sugar polymers. This is what is represented as antigens. I want all of you to remember this. Okay, on top of our plasma membrane of the RBC, this is the plasma membrane. You know that our blood, the major component of our blood is RBC. Since we are talking about blood, let's talk about RBC. On the surface of the plasma membrane of RBC, there is something known as sugar polymers. Okay? There is something known as sugar polymers. They are actually called as antigens. This we have studied when while talking about different blood groups in human beings in the first year class. Now, these sugar polymers are actually controlled by a gene known as gene I in our body. In every human being, there is a gene known as gene I. This gene I controls the type of sugar polymers present on the plasma membrane of RBC in our blood. Okay, what type of sugar polymer should be present on the plasma membrane surface of RBC is decided by this gene, gene I. This gene I, we know that gene exists in alternative forms. It has three alleles known as IA, IB and I. Okay, so this gene I, which actually controls the type of sugar polymers on the RBC's plasma membrane, is having three alleles, IA, IB and I. Okay, now in a human body, I told you that for every character, there are two alleles present and one allele is obtained from the parent, paternal side. One allele is obtained from the maternal side. Then I am saying gene I has three alleles. Even though gene I has three alleles, in every human body, there will be any two alleles from these three combinations. From these three alleles, we will have only two. For example, my blood group is AB. So I have this allele and this allele. I don't have this allele. Okay, so this is the possibility. Even though gene I exists in three different forms, every human being has only two alleles from these three. Any two. It could be, we can make different combinations from these three alleles. We can make different combination. Let me write it. First, let me write IA and, well, let me write IA and IA. We know that for every character we will have two alleles. So we will be having only two alleles in our body for a particular character. Okay. One more combination is I can combine this with I. IA. I. First IA, IA. Then IA, I. Then IB. We will say I consider IB. IB, IB, or IB, I. Then the next combination is IA, IB. Next combination is I and I. You can try writing. From these three alleles, we will get these six possibilities. A person might have IAIA allele, IAI allele, IBIB allele, IBI allele, IAIB allele, or II allele. This is the possible combinations of alleles that could be present in every individual's body. I told you I have blood group AB, so my combination of allele is IAIB. Okay, then if a person, so I have blood group AB, so my possible combination is IAIB. Imagine a person is having the combination of alleles I and I. This person is having blood group O. Okay, then the person is having IAIA combination. This person will be having blood group A. Then what about this condition, IAI? In this condition, IA and I, the person will be again having blood group A. In this condition, IB and IB, the person will be having blood group B. In this case, IB and I, the person will be again having blood group B. Now, let's look into this in detail. I've told you gene I is the gene responsible for what type of sugar polymers should be present on the plasma membrane of RBC in our blood. Okay, now the gene I exists in three different forms, IA, IB and I. Now, if the allele IA is present in a person's body, the type of sugar polymer will be different. If a person is having IB allele on the IB allele, the type of sugar polymer will be different. If a person is having I allele, the type of sugar polymer will be none. Okay? If a person is having IA allele in his chromosome, then the type of sugar polymer will be different. The type of sugar polymer at that particular time, if a person is having IA allele, the type of sugar polymer that is present on the RBC surface, it will be known as antigen A. If a person is having allele IA, this will be responsible for the presence of antigen A on the RBC surface. Antigen A is the sugar polymer that we are talking about. If a person is having IB allele, then the sugar polymer will be of the type antigen B. Okay, the sugar polymer will be, it will code for this particular antigen B. If a person is having allele I, then there is no sugar polymer on the surface of RBC. Okay, so this is the function of IA, IB and I alleles. Okay, the gene I exists in three forms, IA, IB and I. If a person is having IA allele, then this in this person's body on the RBC surface, there will be antigen A. If a person is having IB allele, then the person's RBC will have antigen B on the RBC surface. If a person is having this allele known as I, that means there is no sugar polymer produced by the, there is no sugar polymer on the RBC surface in that person's blood. Okay, now this is the condition. IA allele will produce antigen A, IB allele is responsible for antigen B on the RBC surface. When there is allele I, there is no sugar polymer or there is no antigen on the surface of RBC. Again, I have already mentioned that these alleles will be present in a combination of two in any person's body. So imagine IA. So this person will be producing antigen A. The person will be having antigen A on the RBC surface. IA will produce a sugar polymer which is known as antigen A. I, there is no sugar polymer, so there is only one sugar polymer on the RBC surface. IB and B, it will produce antigen B, so there will be antigen B. This combination on the RBC surface, we will have only one type of antigen, that is antigen A. In this condition, we will have only one antigen because I does not produce any antigen. IB and I, this is antigen A, this is also antigen A, this is antigen B. When there is condition of IB and I, there is again B because IB will produce antigen B. So this is antigen B, I will not produce any antigen. Now, when we talk about IA and IB, this is the special case where on the RBC surface, IA will produce antigen A, this type of sugar polymer. A, there is B. Now there is a question. When there was IA and IA, there is no question, only antigen A. IA and I, there is only antigen A because I does not produce any antigen. IB and B, it will have antigen B. IB and I, again antigen B because I will not produce any antigen. When IA and IB, the question comes, which antigen should be present on the surface of the RBC? Whether it is antigen A or antigen B? The answer is, when there is combination of IA and IB alleles, the RBC will have both antigen A and antigen B on its surface. This is the actual example for codominance. Now, when we have allele, one allele and the other allele, both different alleles, this allele is IA, this allele is IB. Here, no allele is dominant. This allele is not dominant. This allele is not dominant. Both the alleles express and it will show the character of the parent. That means a person who is having IA allele, the organism which is having IA allele and IB allele, both the alleles will express. Okay, this I can explain you with the help of a crossing. Okay, let's take a parent who is having this combination. His blood group is A. This combination where the blood group is B. Right? When this is the father, this is the mother. When they produce the child, let's talk about gametes. They will produce two different types of gametes, IA, I here, IB and I. Now if you write the combination of F1 generation, what we get in F1 generation, then the offspring that we get, it will be, see, IA and IB. The possible combination of children, IA, I, IB, I, then I and I. Okay. Let's consider this case. In this case, if the child is having this combination, IA and I, the child's blood group will be A. It is similar to the blood group of father. There is no speciality here. When the child's blood group has alleles, the child's body has allele in the combination of IB and I, the child will be having blood group B, which is matching the mother. Okay. Now, in this case, the blood group is O, and in this case of IA and IB, C, the person will be having blood group AB. So, the person is having this combination IA and IB, blood group is AB. If you look into the blood group of parents, it is A and B. A of father, B of mother. Whereas the child is having AB, the combination of both. That means the child is resembling both the parents. Right? Father is having A, mother is having B. The child is resembling both the parents here. Right? The child resembles both the parents. If that will be still more easier if we take this combination. When a parent is having A blood group in this combination and B blood group in this combination, the gametes they will produce will be only of one type, IA and IB. When the F1 generation is formed, the baby will be having the combination of both IA and IB. The baby will be having blood group AB. Okay, this is easier than this example. Okay, let's not consider this example as of now. Let's consider only this example. If a father is having A blood group, mother is having B blood group, their allelic combination is this IA, IA, IB, IB. Then the baby that they produce will be having IA and IB. They will be having IA and IB allelic combination, which is AB blood group. See here in this case, when there are two alleles together, both the alleles are expressing themselves, right? This allele is also expressing, so A blood group. This allele is also expressing, so blood group. This is what happened in case of incomplete dominance. Both the alleles expressed, but there the child did not match the parent. Here the child is matching both the parents. The child is having AB blood group, which is of the father's and the mother's character. AB, so AB blood group. This is known as codominance. Both the alleles, IA and IB, they are together. Right? And the F1 generation resemble both the parents, A and B, together in the F1 generation. This is the example for co-dominance. Now, in this combination also, we can see the dominance. Let's talk about this condition, IA and I. When IA and I allele are present, what is the blood group the person will be having? A. That means only this allele is expressing, this allele is not expressing. So this is a dominant allele, this is a recessive allele. Hope this is clear to you. When there is a combination of IA and I, there are two different alleles, then this allele, capital IA, expresses. That is the reason the person will be having A blood group. Let's take this example, IB and I. In case of IB and I, IB is dominant, I is recessive, so the person is having blood group B. Okay, IB is dominant, small I is recessive, so the person is having blood group B. Okay, so when we, and in the case of IA and IB, we know that IA allele is always dominant, IB is always dominant. So when IA and IB come together, both will be dominant, both will express their character. However, they match the character of the parent. Okay, so this is what happens in the case of co-dominance. The F1 generation will resemble both the parents. The F1 generation resembles both the parents. Okay, now I will draw a chart in order to make you make it a little more clearer. draw a column to make this concept still more clear. Okay, here we will write allele from parent 1. Okay, you can take it as a father or mother, it's left to you. Allele from parent 2. If you're taking this as a father, then let's consider this allele as a, this as a mother. Then genotype, we will write what is the combination of genotype. Then we will see the blood group. Okay. So I have told you gene exists in different forms, which is known as alleles. We have two alleles for every character, and out of these alleles, one is obtained from the parent's father's side, the other one is obtained from the maternal side or the mother's side. So if you are considering this as father, then if you receive the allele IA from your father, and if you receive allele I from your mother, the total genotype will be IA and I. So your blood group will be A blood group. Why? Because IA allele is dominant, I allele is recessive. Since IA allele is dominant over the I allele, the blood group of IA allele expresses, right? The allele IA expresses and decides its blood group. Then if you receive allele IA from your father, allele IA from your mother, then the genotype will be IA and IA. Your blood group will be A. Why? Because both the alleles are dominant. They will express their own character. Right? Both the alleles. It is like the case of capital T, where it expresses tallness. Right? Both the alleles are similar and both the alleles are dominant. So they will express their own characters. Then if you are receiving allele IB from your father, allele I from your mother, then the combination will be IB and I. You know, IB and IA are always dominant over the small I, right? IA and IB are always dominant over the small I. So the blood group will be B blood group, right? The blood group will be B because IB is dominant over I. When the combination is IB and IB, if you receive allele IB from your father, allele IB from your mother, then the combination will be IB and IB. You will be having blood group B because both these IB alleles are dominant, right? Both the IB allele and capital IA and capital IB, they are dominant. When they are together, they will show their character, they will show their blood group, which is B. Then comes the combination IA and IB. IA and IB. Now question comes, which allele is dominant? In case of IB and IB, both are dominant, so they will express their character. When there is IA and IB, who is dominant? Who is recessive? Here, nobody is dominant, nobody is recessive. Both are dominant and both will express their character. I said both are not dominant, both are actually dominant, and no allele is recessive here. Both the alleles are dominant and they will express their character by themselves. In case of IA, it will express their character and the blood group will be A. And the IB will express its own character and the blood group will be B. So totally we call them as AB blood group, because they are expressing the character of both father, who is having A, and the mother. Okay, so this is the condition. So this is actual example for co-dominance, AB blood group. Then the last case, I allele, the combination is I and I, so the person's blood group will be O. Okay, it's a recessive allele, so the blood group is O. Now in this case, okay, I hope this is clear to you. When the F1 generation resembles both the parents, that particular condition is known as co-dominance. dominance. Here you have to know about gene I, which actually has three alleles, IA, IB and I. IA and IB are dominant alleles, I is recessive alleles. If there is IA allele in a person's body, the type of sugar polymer or antigen that is produced will be antigen A. If the person's blood group is, the person is having the allele IB, then the type of antigen they produce will be antigen B. If the person is having allele I, then this person will not be having any sugar polymer or antigen on the surface of RBC. Okay, these two alleles are dominant over this allele. So this is the example for co-dominance. I hope this is clear to you. Thank you. The next small topic that we have to study is back cross and test cross. What is a back cross and what is a test cross? Now, if you know the genotype of an individual, then in order to know the genotype of that particular individual, we do this cross known as back cross and test cross. Okay, first let's see what is back cross. It is of less importance. Back cross is, now Mendel has crossed a tall plant with a dwarf plant. Now, when he crossed a tall plant with a dwarf plant, he just knows that this is a tall plant, this is a dwarf plant as pair. Now when he got the F1 generation, he got all tall plants. Now how did he conclude that all these tall plants were capital T, small t? Because if you are getting a tall plant, then there is a condition where this tall plant could also be capital T and capital T, and it could be capital T and small t. If the plant has to be a tall plant, then there are two possible combinations, conditions. It could be capital T, capital T, capital T and small t. Which condition is this? Right? What is the genotype of this particular tall plant, whether this is this or this? In order to know this, if you cross the tall plant or F1 hybrid with, the name itself says it is back cross. You take this particular plant that you got in the F1 hybrid, you cross it with the, you back cross it with the parents, dominant parent and the recessive parent. Okay, if you are thinking that you have got a tall plant, in order to know the genotype of this particular tall plant, unknown genotype, then you do two combinations here. You take this possible combination, you cross it with the parent, one parent, then you take this combination, cross it with the dwarf parent, and you take this pair, hybrid, and cross it with the, we have already done it. Okay, now you take this combination and cross it with the tall plant of the parental generation. You take this possible combination, cross it with the recessive parent. Okay, you take the F1 hybrid, you cross it with both the dominant parent and the recessive parent. You take the F1, we have got tall plant. In tall plant, there could be two possible options. Either it could be capital T, capital T, capital T, small t. So in order to identify this, you take this particular combination, right? You take this particular combination and you cross them with dominant parent and recessive parent. You take one more combination for tallness, possibility for tallness, right? This combination, and you cross it with the dominant parent and the recessive parent. Based on the result that we get, Mendel concluded whether this particular F1 hybrid is a tall, it is definitely a tall plant. What is the genotype? Whether it is capital T, capital T, capital T, small t. Okay, so we don't have to study this in detail. As I told you, according to your syllabus, this is of less importance. what is important for you is the test cross. So let's see what is a test cross. Now, test cross is a condition where you cross the plants, a tall plant with a dwarf plant, you got F1 tall. You have two chances, you have confusion whether this tall plant is capital T, capital T, or this tall plant is capital T, small t. Because you can just observe the external appearance, however you cannot conclude what is the genotype for that particular behavior or that particular character, right? You don't know whether that is capital T, capital T, or capital T, small t, which is deciding the tallness in the F1 hybrid. So what you do, you cross these plants only with the parental, recessive parent. Okay, what you do in F1 generation, you have two possibilities whether this plant would be capital T, capital T, capital T, small t. So you take this particular plant and cross it with the recessive parent. This is the dominant parent. This is the recessive parent. With the help of alphabets itself, we can make out, right? The capital letters one are dominant, the small letter ones are recessive parent. Now you take this combination that you got in F1 generation, you cross it with the recessive parent. Okay, again you take this combination, you don't know the possibility, you're just trying your luck, right? And you take this plant and cross it again with the recessive parent. When you cross the F1 generation with only the recessive parent, that becomes test cross. Okay, when you cross the F1 hybrid with the recessive parent, that becomes test cross. When you cross the F1 hybrid with both dominant parent and recessive parent, that becomes back cross. Okay, here we are more concerned about test cross. We want to know the genotype of the unknown genotype of this particular F1 tall plant. Okay, so you are only imagining if the phenotype is tall, the genotype could be both capital T or capital T small t. So you take both the options and you cross it with the recessive parent. Capital TT with the recessive parent, capital T small t again with the recessive parent. Okay, then what is the option that we get? We will do the crossing for this particular using a Punnett square. Okay, we will do this combination here and this combination here. We'll write capital T, capital T here, small t here. Let's write all the possible combination: capital T, small t, capital T, small t, capital T, small t, capital T, small t. So we got all tall plants. Right? Now let's do the combination here. Capital T, small t, small t, small t. See this condition. Here, you compare both the Punnett square. Here, all the plants that we got is tall, right? Or they are tall. All the plants that we got are tall. In this Punnett square, you see, half of the plants that we got are tall, half of the plants that we got are dwarf. However, just think, in F1 plant, in F1 generation, all the plants that we got were tall, right? From the monohybrid cross, I am saying that all the plants that we get in F1 generation are tall plants. However, according to this crossing, we got 50% tall and 50% dwarf in the F1 generation itself. Did we get this combination, 50% tall and 50% dwarf? No, we never got any dwarf plants in the F1 generation. We got all tall plants. So, which condition is applying or which Punnett square is matching with this result? All tall, this Punnett square. Right? This Punnett square is not matching with this F1 result, because in F1 it is saying if the combination was capital T and small t, we should have got all the 50% tall plant and 50% dwarf plants. Now, however, we have got all the tall plants, right? Cut money. Okay. Now, a point to think here is that now in F1 generation, you got tall plants. You imagine two possibilities of genotype for this particular phenotype. Now, you crossed this particular genotype with the recessive pair. Now, in this crossing, we got all tall plants. Here in this particular crossing, we got all 50% tall and 50% dwarf plants. Now, this Punnett square result, you should compare with the result of your F1 generation. Okay? In the F1 generation, out of all the plants that you got, if all are tall, then you can conclude the genotype of this particular tall plant as capital T, capital T. You don't have to worry about monohybrid cross of Mendel. You just are worried about knowing the unknown genotype of this particular tall plant. If in your F1 plant, when you grew the plants, all the plants were tall, then that indicates that the possible genotype for that particular tall plant is capital T, capital T. However, when you are growing the F1 plants and few plants turned out to be tall and few plants turned out to be dwarf, then you can conclude that the genotype of this particular tall plant is capital T, small t. So, by looking at the result of F1 plants, the phenotype or the physical appearance of that particular plants, you can conclude whether the genotype is capital T, capital T, or the genotype is capital T, small t. Okay, you just have to look at the plants that you got in the F1 generation. You can't decide the genotype by looking at the plant. You can just know the phenotype. You know the phenotype, you do the crossing with the recessive parent. Ultimately, the result you get when you cross these plants with the recessive parent, if you get all the tall plants, then you can conclude that that particular genotype of this F1 tall plant was capital T, capital T. And if the result that you get is matching with the test cross result in the F1 generation, then you can conclude that the genotype of this particular tall plant is capital T and small t. Okay, so this is all about back cross and test cross. I hope this is clear to you. And this is back cross and test cross, both are conducted to know the unknown genotype of a F1 individual, or if any individual whose genotype is not known and you just know the phenotype, then you do the back crossing and test crossing and you get the result. Okay, I hope this is clear to you. If you have any doubts, you can get back to me. Thank you.